Jananing Saradang Deving Ramakrishnang Jagadgurung Padapadmeta Shritva Pranamami Muhurmuhu. Respected Professor Jitendranath Mahanti, respected Professor Pradyut Kumar Mukhopadhyay, revered monks and brahmacharins of Ramakrishna order, learned delegates, students and friends. At the outset, I wish to express my profound gratitude to Swami Tyagarupananda Maharaji, Adhyaksha Ramakrishna Mission Vidya Mandir, for being kind enough to consider me to deliver a speech on Sri Ramakrishna's idea from feminist perspective. I, on my part, consider this to be a very rare privilege and honor. My paper, Sri Ramakrishna from Feminist Perspective and Observation, comprises of three sections. The first section deals very briefly with what is feminism, the relation between feminism and spirituality, and the allegations of the feminists against religion in general. In the second section, I have tried to analyze whether these allegations are applicable to Sri Ramakrishna. The third section deals with the question, is Sri Ramakrishna a misogynist, and my comments. Feminism in India is a recent phenomenon. It is a Western concept. In West, its roots go back as far as the Enlightenment of the 18th century and especially the liberalism of the 19th century. It was mainly the freedom struggle, a movement to overcome the oppression of an indiscrimination against women, which is deeply embedded in social and cultural institutions. David Bokier, in his study, The Feminist Challenge, uses a definition which covers the whole range of feminist beliefs and practices. For him, feminism includes any form of opposition to any form of social, personal, or economical discrimination which women suffer because of their sex. Feminism is not only a social and political movement. In contemporary culture, it functions as a critical category because it challenges and examines the foundations of our language, thought, and institutions, our social and political power structures and their hierarchical divisions. A question arises, how do feminism and spirituality relate to each other? Feminism is an important social and political movement which perhaps yet not come of age. Spirituality, on the other hand, has to do with an age-old human quest to seek fulfillment, liberation, and pointers towards transcendence amidst the welter of human experience. The term spirituality is easily misunderstood. It is too often associated with an exclusively quote-unquote religious or even ascetic stance separate from the secular world. Many, though not all, spiritual teachers of the past have preached and practiced a world-denying spirituality based on a sharp distinction, separation of the different spheres of human experience, a separation which has been altogether unwholesome. However, spirituality must not be understood as something apart from or as something added to life. Rather, it is something which permeates all human activities and experiences rather being additional to them. Spirituality can be described as a process of transformation and growth, an organic and dynamic part of human development of both individual and society. The feminist thinkers view religion and spirituality in two ways. Positively, it seeks to discover different, more integral world and life-affirming possibilities. Negatively, it challenges traditional religions and spiritualities for their exclusiveness, their rejection and subordination of women. In public discussions about spirituality, usually conducted by professional theologians or religiously committed people, feminist voices on spirituality have so far been little noted. Feminists all over the world are better known for their critique of traditional religion than for their views on spirituality. It has also been shown that on the whole, feminists tend to be less religious in a traditional sense than non-feminist women. The sharp feminist critique of religion challenges important aspects of religious teachings. However, there are feminists who are convinced that religion is profoundly important. For them, the discovery that religions teach the inferiority of women is experienced as a betrayal of deeply felt spiritual and religious experiences. They are convinced that religion must be reformed and reconstructed to support full human dignity of women. Before discussing Sri Ramakrishna from feminist perspective, let us see the arguments in brief given by the feminists against tradition and religion in general. Feminists have charged that Judaism, Christianity and Islam are sexist religion with a male god, and all traditional religions in general have traditions of male leadership that legitimate the superiority of men in family and society. Though feminist voices express concern and protest about many specific issues, but fundamentally all criticisms and campaigns are rooted in an outright challenge to patriarchy and androcentrism. Generally, patriarchy means a hypothetical social system based on the absolute authority of the father or an elderly male over the family group. The feminists allege that wherever one looks in the world, religious institutions are dominated by men. Women are largely invisible or at least marginal to the public positions of power, authority and hierarchy. There are hardly ever official spokeswomen of religious institutions, whereas the grassroots level of women almost everywhere in the world form the majority of participants in ordinary day-to-day religious life. Whilst God, as an all-encompassing ultimate reality, transcends the difference of sex, this reality has in many religions been predominantly presented as father rather than as mother. The feminists have raised another question. Is there any room for women in religion? Sometimes one thinks not. It is therefore not surprising that different feminists take a very different stance towards religion. Some reject it outright. They simply see religion as an external institution, authority and power structure which keeps people in a state of dependence and thereby prevents them from acquiring autonomy, from the will to actively shape their lives and take full responsibility for it. Related to it, another question arises. What status and role do particular religion assign to women? What are the patterns of participation or exclusion from ritual and liturgy? What kind of religious authority can women wield in what kind of religious institution? Are women given equal status in religious life, that is, the priesthood where it exists and in various forms of monasticism? Here, the challenge is about the lack of official recognition, the absence of power and status, invisible hierarchies, the subservient and frequent invisible role played by many women throughout the world. It may be mentioned here that like feminism, the concepts of equality, freedom and hierarchy are also Western concepts. The most decisive difference between the, that is the origin from Semitic religion. The most decisive difference between the Semitic and the non-Semitic religions lies in the doctrine of man. Man or woman, as a personal being, endowed with freedom and the consequent responsibility for his own actions, is not fully recognized in the non-Semitic religions of the East. In Advaita Vedanta, for example, man as an empirical ego arises just like a single wave in the vast ocean of infinity, Brahman, to be reabsorbed again within it. In like manner, Buddhism views man as nothing more than a meeting point of five ever-changing elements, panchaskandhas. The general emphasis of these religions is not on man conceived as a personal agent, but on some sort of impersonal cosmic moral law, rito, radrishto, apurva, towards which the entire course of nature, human life and society are oriented. In fact, anthropocentrism is practically unknown in the East. But this anthropocentrism is the very heart of the Semitic religions. In Semitic religions, the focus is not so much on the cosmic moral law as on the individual man and his freedom. And again, there is also a difference in the concept of creation. In the Semitic religions, the theory of creation is linear. There is a beginning and an end. But in Hinduism, the creation theory is cyclical. There is neither beginning nor end. In Semitic religions, the creator is a male god who first created Adam, the first man in the universe. From his ribs, he was created. From the very beginning, there is a hierarchy. But in Indian religions of Indian origin, the question of hierarchy does not arise. Indian philosophy and religion, with its concepts of values, ultimate goal in life, grew in this context. When we try to analyze and examine Indian tradition from the Western point of view, we get confused. A cross-cultural historical study of the role and status of women in different religious traditions shows that the less differentiated the religion and society are, the greater is the participation of women. Thus, it is true on the whole that women had higher position in archaic, ancient, tribal and relatively non-institutionalized forms of religion, and Hinduism falls in this category. Keeping these points in view, I shall now try to understand Sri Ramakrishna. When Sri Ramakrishna was born, British rule was well established in India. The Renaissance of Bengal as well as of India started at the beginning of 19th century. Raja Ram Mohan Roy, the pioneer of our Renaissance, died at Bristol in 1833, 3 years before Sri Ramakrishna's birth. Shoti system was abolished. When Sri Ramakrishna came to Dakshineshwar, Brahmo religion was in its peak form. In Calcutta, there were leaders like Devendranath Tagore, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, Keshav Chandra Sen, Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay. Various reformation movements were launched. The Brahmo Samaj launched a movement to reform Hindu society along with the reforms of religion. Women education, women emancipation, removal of caste system were in their agenda. Sri Ramakrishna was by no means a social reformer, not that he wanted to be. But in his life, what he did by initiating followers without any discrimination of caste and his concept towards women's position in society, women's position in religious order, left a mark in Indian social reform movement. Let us now see whether the charges against religion by feminist thinkers are applicable to Sri Ramakrishna. The main charge of the feminist against religion is that traditional religions are male-centric with a male god, male leadership and patriarch. According to Sri Ramakrishna, God can be worshipped in female form also. Of course, this is the speciality of Hinduism. Most of the religions of the world consider God as man, a male figure. Sri Ramakrishna gave the idea of motherhood of God a sort of special sanctity. He worshipped God as a mother of universe, and he often used to say that all women represents the divine motherhood on earth. According to him, among all the relationship, all the attitude towards God, this motherhood of God is the best and purest. So the first charge of the feminist does not apply to Sri Ramakrishna. Not only that, Sri Ramakrishna with firm conviction said, when I think of the Supreme Being as inactive, neither creating nor preserving nor destroying, I call him Brahma nor Purusha, the impersonal God. When I think of him as active, creative, preserving, destroying, I call him Shakti or Maya or Prakriti, the personal God. But the distinction between them does not mean a difference. The personal and the impersonal are the same being, like milk and its whiteness, the diamond and its luster, or the serpent and its undulations. It is impossible to conceive of one without the other. The Divine Mother and Brahman are one. Sri Ramakrishna went far, far beyond the distinction between male and female. So the allegation of androcentricism cannot be applied to Sri Ramakrishna. To Sri Ramakrishna, the absolute and the relative are equally divine. He saw Kali appearing in so many garbs. He saw mother in the prostitute Ramani, saw mother in a little Muslim girl. All women are veritable images of Shakti. All women are Anandamayi. The primal power that has become the women and appear in the form of every woman. For the first time in the history of religion's history of the world, this idea was preached by a sadhaka, spiritual person. But it is very difficult for a common man, ordinary people, to look at women in this way. Professor A.P. Sen has rightly said, quote, "But the deep sense of respect for women that he sought to inculcate was an essential precondition for the success of any effort aimed at the elevation of women's position in society. The genuine reverence for womanhood preached by Sri Ramakrishna was intrinsically a superior social attitude to compassion, pity, and sense of male superiority and righteousness that motivated most of the advocates of social reform." End quote. Swami Vivekananda once describes Ramakrishna as a savior of women. Sri Ramakrishna, after practicing 64 tantras current in India, concluded that Panchamukha was not necessary, absolutely necessary. He maintained the filial attitude towards women while even while practicing the tantric mode of worship. The Indian Mirror observed that the place which Sri Ramakrishna assigned to women was far higher than which the passion of man might reach. As opposed to androcentricism, the psychoanalysts may charge him of gynecocentricism. It may be noted here that in the opinion of some psychoanalysts like Sudhir Kakkar, the male safe part of Sri Ramakrishna's personality was split off in early childhood after his father's death and tended to grow, if at all, rather slowly. In the contrary, the female self part of his personality dominated his inner psychic reality. Swami Saradananda also noticed these both male-female characteristics in his personality. Sometimes in him, the feminine characteristics were dominant and sometimes masculine characteristics prevailed. For his Nari Bhav, attitude of a woman, acceptance of Sri Guru and Matri Sadhana, some may term his attitude gynecocentric. It may be mentioned here that his first disciple was also a woman, his wife Sharada Devi, and perhaps Gorima was his second disciple who was initiated by him in the Nimtighola garden, as we find in Gorima's biography written by Durgapuri Devi. We have already mentioned that the feminists question regarding the status and role of women in particular religion. Are women given equal status in the religious life, that is priesthood? Since the advent of Sri Ramakrishna, a new age has started where men and women are given equal rights in spirituality and religion. He himself accepted the Sonnashiri Bhairavi Jogeshwari as one of his gurus, as the first guru, and did spiritual practices under his tutelage. He said that she was not just learned but knowledge personified. As even an exemplary aspirant like Sri Ramakrishna accepted her as his guru, it proves that women do not only have equal rights but can reach such heights and become a spiritual guru. Sri Ramakrishna gave ochre cloth to Gaurima, who eventually started Sharadeshwari Ashram, a monastic organization as instructed by Sri Ramakrishna to educate the Bengali women. Sri Ramakrishna has a good number of women devotees. Among them were frequent visitors like Nistarini Devi, Aghormoni Devi, Golapma, Joginma. There were other female devotees whom he himself encouraged to visit more often. He taught them how to practice job, how to worship. Sri Ramakrishna correctly understood all the moods of women. The sight of fasting women pained him. Sri Ramakrishna's attitude towards women is presented in the reminiscence of a woman devotee. Quote, "To us, women devotees, he did not usually seem to be a man at all. It seemed that he was one of us. That is why we did not feel the slightest shyness or hesitation in his presence, as we normally do in the presence of men. If, however, such a feeling came on rare occasions, we forgot it and immediately and would express him our thoughts without any hesitation, whatever." End quote. The fact that he accepted a woman as a guru, practiced spirituality both in male and female garb, presented Gerua to Gauri Ma, his attitude towards women may be taken to signify women's equal status in spiritual sphere. Sri Ramakrishna from feminist perspective will be incomplete without the reference of Sharada Devi. Through his concert, Sharada Devi, Ramakrishna presented his own ideal of womanhood, the role of women in a household and the role of a partner in a higher spiritual life. It is well known that Sri Ramakrishna's marriage to Sharada Devi was never consummated. It is also well known to all that in the year 1872, Sri Ramakrishna worshipped Sharada Devi, his 18 years old wife, as Shoroshi. Worshipping one's wife as a goddess was not new in India. Among the Tantrikas, it is a usual practice. But what is unique in Sri Ramakrishna is that after worshipping the consort, the Tantrikas used to live a conjugal life. But Sri Ramakrishna established the truth of spiritual marriage in the soul plane alone. He always treated his wife with reverence and looked upon her as a representative of Ma Kali. He himself declared about this worship, Shoroshi Puja, to his devotees, and thus gave Sharada Devi a special place in the Ramakrishna movement hierarchy. Not only that, he sent two of his young devotees to get initiated from Sharada Devi. Gradually, Sharada Devi became a pillar of strength for Ramakrishna organization after Sri Ramakrishna's death. This is also a fact that the history of world's religion, Sharada Devi was the first head Sangha Janani of a monastic organization run by monks only. At the same time, she was the life force inspiration of Sharadeshwari Ashram, named after her, founded by the monastic disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, Gauri Ma. It is also known to all that Sharada Devi's decision was the final word in any matter in the Ramakrishna organization. Even Sri Ramakrishna himself did not dare to go against her wishes. This phenomena also drew the attention of feminist scholars of West. Ursula King, in her book Women and Spirituality, writes, quote, at the time of a new religious breakthrough, when a charismatic personality, an enlightened being, shapes a new way of life, new seeds of liberation are sown. In such a period of flux, women, in their support of new movements or reform, or radical renewal, often have greater freedom than is customary in their environment and play a crucial role in the early development of a religion. Sharada Devi played a decisive role in a Ramakrishna movement. She became a guru in her own right and subsequently inspired the foundation of Hindu woman convents of future generation. End quote. But Sri Ramakrishna's attitude towards his wife didn't go unnoticed. It was criticized at that time, and that criticism is still alive. There was a debate on some speculation on Sri Ramakrishna's marriage to Sharada Devi and their marital relation. The Brahmo Samaj leader Pratap Chandra Mojumdar, in a letter to Max Muller, accused Ramakrishna of almost barbarous treatment to his wife. His accusations were Sri Ramakrishna neglected his wife till she was 17 years of age. Not only P.C. Mojumdar, but others also, and still today, some women admirers feel that Sharada Devi was, and Professor A.P. Sen also has written in his book, Sharada Devi was forced to live alone like a widow, even with her husband alive. They also accused Ramakrishna for marrying a 6-year-old girl when he was of 24 years. They also accuse him that Sharada Devi once expressed her desire to be a biological mother. Over and above this, Sharada Devi had to live in the small Nohabat Khana, had to share space with others, and her only duty was to serve Sri Ramakrishna and his devotees. Sometimes she even couldn't see her husband once in a day or once in a month. Regarding Mojumdar's charges against Sri Ramakrishna, Max Muller said this act can hardly be called barbarous in India, where it is recognized custom that a little girl in her 6 years of age as Sharada Devi was when Sri Ramakrishna married her, should remain at her parents' home for years before migration to the house of her husband or his parents. Max Muller agreed with the personal testimony of Swami Vivekananda, who claimed that Sri Ramakrishna treated his young wife Sharada with every consideration and kindness, which Sharada Devi also expressed later, Ridhaye Sheshumoye Jano Anandir Ghat Punno Sthapita Rohiyache Eiru Bodhoito. Max Muller also cites the testimony of Mrs. Olive Bull, who was the first non-Indian to meet Sharada Devi. From her testimony, the spirit, personality and intelligence of Sharada Devi becomes evident. We find the metamorphosis of a little village girl under the tutelage of her husband. Mrs. Olive Bull said, when asked to define the obedience to a guru, who in her case was her husband, she replied to the effect that when one has chosen a guru or teacher, one should listen to and obey all his directions for spiritual advancement. But in things temporal, one could most truly serve a guru by using one's own best discernment. Even if at times it were not in agreement with suggestions given. End quote. Sharada Devi's statement proves that she was not any ordinary woman who had to accept whatever her husband wished or asked. Whatever she did was her decision and not of others. Max Muller cites Olive Bull's letter, when she gladly gave her husband, to whom she had been united by child marriage, her assent that he should lead a sannyasi's life, she gained his intimate friendship and became his disciple. She had also taken the vow of poverty, austerity, and chastity. And renouncing the joy of a natural mother, she became with him the spiritual parent of many children. Max Muller thinks that Sri Ramakrishna's attitude towards his wife was not barbarous. Sharada Devi herself evidently did not think so, nor anyone have heard any other cruelties on the part of her husband. Max Muller concludes, if she was satisfied with her life, who has any right to complain? And is love between husband and wife really impossible without procreation of children? Professor A.P. Sen, in his Ramakrishna Paramahansa, the Sadhuka of Dakshineshwar, raises a question which very often arises in the minds of women admirers of Sri Ramakrishna. The question is, if Sri Ramakrishna wanted to lead a monastic life, why he agreed to marriage? In his Lila Prasanga, Swami Sharadananda explains, through this marriage, Ramakrishna was practically setting an example that total continence is possible even in conjugal life. After all, for an unmarried man, it might have been easy to preach continence, because he was never sufficiently tempted. It seems that Sri Ramakrishna wanted to lead a monastic life. Professor Sen raises another point. He says, on closer scrutiny, Swami Saradananda's thesis appears to border on hagiographic admiration. First, it is an error to presume that Sri Ramakrishna was pledged to a life of monasticism. If he had been so, he certainly would not have broken the pledge. Second, it is also an error to imagine that sexual desire is produced and fulfilled only in wedlock. By marrying Sharada Devi, he was fulfilling a social or ritual obligation, a sanskar. Here too, there is a tradition of having a child, specifically a son, that is also sanskar, which Ramakrishna did not fulfill. End quote. I couldn't find an explanation to this. The woman admirers of Maharaj is here, I'd like to get an answer. The woman admirers of Sri Ramakrishna, right from Jyotirmoy Devi to my girl students and some of my colleagues, accuse him of being a misogynist. The frequent use of the phrase in his discourse, Kamini Kanchan Tag, is the reason of this misunderstanding. Sri Ramakrishna warned his devotees that women and gold were the biggest impediments to spiritual progress. According to these women admirers, how can a person to whom all women are representative of Divine Mother make such a derogatory remark? Swami Nikhilananda, the translator of Kathamrita, explained that by Kamini Kanchan, He meant only lust and greed, the baneful influence of which deters aspirants' spiritual growth. He used the word kamini or women as a concrete term for the sixth instinct when addressing his main devotees. He advised women, on the other hand, to shun men. Kanchan or gold symbolizes greed, which is the other obstacle to spiritual life. So Ramakrishna never taught his disciples to hate any woman or womankind in general. So Ramakrishna used to train his women disciples very similarly. Swami Saradananda wrote, once he said to one of them who was particularly soft-hearted, suppose someone you know takes pains to help you on all occasions, but you feel that it is because he is under the spell of your beauty, which he is too weak to break, would you be kind to that man? Wouldn't you, on the other hand, deal a hard kick to his chest and stay away from him? So Ramakrishna, to his male aspirants, used to say, there are two kinds of women, Vidya Shakti and Abidya Shakti. A woman endowed with spiritual attributes leads a man to God, but a woman who is the embodiment of delusion makes him forget God and drowns him in the ocean of worldliness. Similarly, we can also make a distinction among the men. Men having Devo Bhavo and men having Asura Bhavo. And I'm sure the ladies present here will agree with me in this. Sarada Devi, in a very strong language, once warned one of her devotee, young devotee, not to believe any man, even if he comes in the garb of God. What Ramakrishna wanted to mean by Kamini Kanchan Tyag is that everywhere it is true that sexually alluring woman or man and greed for material wealth bind a person to this world. And then she or he loses all his or her freedom. It is for the sake of lust, desire, one needs wealth. And that entails bondage from where the man and or woman is no longer free. To Bijaya Krishna Goswami, this is translated by Professor A.P. Sen. I have taken it from his words, the book. To Bijaya Krishna Goswami, he said, you can see for yourself what accepting service under another does to a man, don't you? And do you see how the highly educated people, masters of English language, have to suffer kicks from the master's boots every day? At the root of all this is kamini. Once you marry and have domestic life, it is impossible to wind it up. It is thus insult after insult is heaped on the man, and he has to undergo the terrible pain of servitude. End quote. This is also true in case of women, from a different perspective. The root cause for the suffering of women are also lust and greed. That Sri Ramakrishna was not a misogynist is evident from his compassion to women, his concern for them, which he conveyed to Gauri Ma. That he did not discriminate between women from different strata of society is evident from his attitude towards the stage actresses. In the 19th century Calcutta, where the elite society, personality like Rabindranath Tagore, Pandit Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, Herombachandra Maitreya, shunned theater performances because some of the artists were well-known prostitutes. On the other hand side, Sri Ramakrishna used to frequent theaters and loved to watch them. We know, and when Binodini Dashi, the famous actress, bowed down herself in reverence, Sri Ramakrishna blessed her, which was unthinkable at that time. And also, it is interesting to note that Professor Shivnath Shastri stopped visiting Dakshineshwar after knowing that Sri Ramakrishna used to visit theatre and loved to watch them. Professor A.P. Sen, in his book, noted that many women of disrepute changed the direction of their lives by resettling in areas close to Dakshineshwar. Some of them were Chopola Sundari, a Brahmin widow forced to prostitution, Mokshoda Sundari, a former actress, Thako, and singer Padmarani, who started singing Kirtan at the bidding of Sri Ramakrishna. It is very important that Sri Ramakrishna's repeated warning of shunning Kamini and Kanchan was not for all of his visitors. Three types of people used to visit Dakshineshwar. The first type was interested in sightseeing and mandir visit. Sri Ramakrishna used to tell them to visit Rashmani's garden. His discourse was surely not meant for them. This type is mainly interested in worldly enjoyment. There is second type of people who enjoy the world but at the same time also want to keep his or her mind in God. And the third type are socially totally devoted to spirituality, to asceticism. So Ramakrishna's discourse was and is specially meant for these two types of people. Among these spiritual aspirants were young students, deputy, doctors, officials working under British government, Brahmo devotees and other professionals. Among the visitors, there were the parents who have lost their child, childless widows, women deserted by husband. Except young student and some young devotees, the rest were householders and discourse of Kathamrita was meant for them. The young students and young devotees already were secretly bonding themselves under his direct supervision and tutelage. The important thing is that this prescribed avoidance of women was only for beginners. Once mystical knowledge is gained, sexual differentiation to vanish. So Ramakrishna said, then you don't have much fear. After reaching the roof, you can dance as much as you like, but not on the stairs. One devotee once asked him, should we hate women? So Ramakrishna answered, one who has realized God ceases to see the women in her carnal form. Henceforth, he needed have no fear of women, for he begins to see in her the manifestation of the goddess. He then begins to worship every woman as the divine mother. Life is a journey towards perfection. Indian philosophy speaks of four ideals which serve as means to reach the end of human endeavor. They are known as purusharthas and consists of dharma, righteousness, artha, wealth, kama, desire and moksha, liberation. The purusharthas deal with the covetable things of life. These are also known as values of life. Every man wants to be happy, wants pleasure and success. Fulfillment of desire is a valid goal of life. To fulfill this goal, that is desire, one needs wealth, artha. But this artha and kama should not be such as to deprive other or to exploit other. To control the unrestrained desire for pleasure and wealth, another value is essential, that is dharma or righteousness, inspired by the consideration for the other man. Both artha and kama are not intrinsic goods. They are good only insofar as they lead to righteous living or a life of duty. It is the pursuit of virtue that makes wealth and desire acceptable in the Hindu scheme of things. Artha and kama do not satisfy man permanently. The hunger of the soul is fulfilled by attaining moksha or freedom. This freedom is different from the modern Western concept of freedom, freedom in society. It is similar to Christian concept of this freedom is similar to Christian concept of return of the prodigal son, reunion with the father in the kingdom of God. This ideal of freedom can be realized in the realm of spirit, and the bliss that follows is everlasting. The basic requirement of achieving this state is renunciation, renunciation of any kind of desire. Then only a person will know his true self. He will be liberated. It is known to all that to Sri Ramakrishna, ultimate goal of human life is God realization. That is the end. But he does not ignore or despise other ends of life like kama, artha and dharma. According to the devotee's adhikar bhed, tendency, temperament and nature, he would advise some people to live the householder's life, do its duties, have children, earn money, maintain family, roshe boshe share mate thako. But with the knowledge that wealth and desire are not the end of life, it does not enable us to see God. Again, to some of his devotees, according to their nature, mental makeup, he would advise them to renunciate the desire of pleasure, to shun lust and greed in the strictest sense of the term. It should be noted that Sri Ramakrishna never forced anyone to follow his path or discourse. His discourse was for those only who visited him at Dakshineshwar or attended his meetings in Calcutta. His discourse was and is mainly meant for the seekers, seekers of truth, seekers of liberation. Indian philosophy prescribes two different ways for achieving this value of life. They are Prabhritti Margo and Nibritti Margo. If anyone chooses the former and wants to enjoy the life, fulfill his carnal desire, there is no question of renunciation, no separation from wealth or desire. But if one chooses a second, the Nibritti Margo, the path described as Kuroshadhara Durato Nishitaya Durgama Patho, and opts for self-realization, God-realization, then all religions of the world are unanimous here that one has to take leave from desire and passion. For men, they are woman and wealth, and for women, they are man and wealth. I'd like to conclude with Tulsidas' doha, Jaha Ram taha kama nahi, jaha kama taha nahi ram, duhu milata nahi, rabar rajani ektam. Thank you. Namaskar.